So I recently put out a video where I discussed how Snowball Earth, an event in which Earth was nearly completely covered in ice, might have actually helped encourage the evolution of animal life. But many people discuss Snowball Earth as having caused major biological devastation. So which is it? Did Snowball Earth cause major explosions or extinctions of life? Well, it turns out that it was both. Snowball Earth caused major biological devastation in a mass extinction event potentially larger than any other mass extinction event in Earth's history. But it also led to the major explosions of life in the Ediacaran and Cambrian periods that followed. Because I talked about how it might have induced those explosions of life, specifically in multicellularity animals, in my previous video that I was talking about, I'll link that up here if you're interested. Today, we're going to focus on the mass extinction part. So first things first, I want to give a little background in terms of why this event even happened. And to do that, I need to discuss oxygen on Earth. Oxygen is the gas in our atmosphere that we breathe to metabolize and gain energy, but oxygen hasn't always been present on Earth. Currently, it makes up about 20% of our atmosphere, but on early Earth, before about 2.4 billion years ago, so from 4.5 to 2.4-ish billion years ago, there was negligible oxygen in Earth's atmosphere and ocean. But around 2.4 billion years ago began the rise of oxygen with what we call the Great Oxidation Event. This event marked the very first rise in atmospheric oxygen on Earth, and then later we had the Neoproterozoic Oxygenation Event around 700-ish million years ago, where we had another pulse of oxygen rise, which brought us to near modern levels of oxygen in our atmosphere and oceans. The first event, the GEO, was caused by the evolution and spread of photosynthesizing bacteria, which obviously photosynthesis produces oxygen, but that had not been around before, at least not photosynthesis that produced oxygen. But then it evolved and cyanobacteria, the ones that were doing it, spread globally enough to the point that eventually we had that big spike in oxygen concentrations that we call the GEO. The NOE was caused again by another kind of spike or proliferation of photosynthesizing organisms, namely the evolution and spread of eukaryotic photosynthesizing organisms that we call algae, but it was also caused by other factors like the breakup of Rodinia, one of the first supercontinents in Earth's history, which led to a lot of continental weathering or an increase in the rate of continental weathering, which, as I've talked about in many of my videos, causes an increased rate of carbon burial. And we know that the burial of carbon or removal of carbon from the atmosphere into the biosphere, hydrosphere, or geosphere causes atmospheric cooling because it decreases the greenhouse effect. And at this time, well, both of these pulses of oxygenation, the GEO and the NOE, are associated with major cooling, major glaciation events that we call snowball Earth events because they covered Earth in ice much more completely than any ice age event that we've had after the NOE. Of these two major spikes in oxygen, the GEO and the NOE, and their associated glaciations or snowball Earth events, the NOE caused snowball Earth event is much more well known and widely accepted as a near global to global glaciation event. The timing of the GEO being 2.4 billion years ago makes it such that evidence for a snowball Earth at that time is, one, hard to come by because the rock record is much less abundant for 2.4 billion year old rocks compared to 700 million year old rocks. So that's one reason that we don't have as much evidence to back up that glaciation event compared to the NOE one. But it is also possible that that one just wasn't as global of a glaciation. We don't really know for sure exactly what went on at that time. So that one's hard to say. But the good news is, in this video, we're focusing on the major snowball Earth event, which is the one that's associated with the NOE, or the Neoproterozoic Oxygenation Event, that occurred around 700 million years ago. This snowball Earth event is called the Cryogenian Snowball Earth. However, it's kind of two two different glaciation pulses. One is called the Sturtian, which occurred around 716 million years ago. And then there was kind of an interglacial period where the ice melted away again a little bit, but then immediately thereafter, there was another spike in glaciation that we call the Maranoan, which occurred around 650 to 635 million years ago. Both of these pulses of glaciation together are called the Cryogenian Snowball Earth. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, I discussed recently how this event increased, well, oxygen levels, obviously, it was an oxygenation event, and the viscosity of the ocean, or kind of thickness of the seawater, to the point that favored the evolution and spread of multicellular animals. Obviously, we know that oxygen is important for animal evolution because animals breathe oxygen. However, it's thought that before the NOE, oxygen levels could have allowed the evolution of animals. So it's not necessarily that the oxygen rise at the NOE alone caused the evolution and proliferation of animals right after in the Ediacaran and Cambrian explosions. Rather, we think now that other factors like the viscosity of the ocean also played a role in helping force the evolution and proliferation of animals during and right after the Snowball Earth event in the Ediacaran and Cambrian periods. As we can see here, the Ediacaran and Cambrian periods directly follow the Cryogenian glaciations or Snowball Earth event, which mark the evolution of the first simple animal ecosystems in the Ediacaran around 635 million years ago, and then obviously the huge explosion of more diverse animal ecosystems in the Cambrian around 539 million years ago. And again, if you want to know how viscosity played a role, check out that video that I linked up to the top right earlier. But in this video, as we discussed, we'll be talking about how Snowball Earth also caused major devastation at the time and mass extinctions. One way Snowball Earth caused biological devastation was by blocking photosynthesis. Obviously, the nearly complete ice cover of Earth's oceans would have blocked a lot of photosynthetic activity. And remember, we're thinking mainly of oceans here because there was really no land or terrestrial life yet. There may have been some microbes, but there was no big trees or forests or, you know, ecosystems on land until hundreds of millions of years later. Ocean microbes like cyanobacteria and algae were the major photosynthesizers at the time, and when ice covered the ocean, it made it really hard for sunlight to get through for photosynthesis. And this caused cascading extinctions down the food chain. If the photosynthesizers, the primary producers, the guys that produce the food using the light, can't make the food for the rest of the food chain in that marine ecosystem, then that marine ecosystem dies. And this is one reason we switched from previous thinking, in that we used to think that Snowball Earth was a period in which Earth was completely covered in ice. However, this would have likely caused a complete extinction of all photosynthetic life and all life that relies on those phototrophs. Yes, microbes often have the capability of being kind of dormant for a while in like spore mode and then coming back to life once conditions are good again. I know this because I cultured bacteria in the lab for 5 years, and my bacteria were extremely resilient because they could go dormant and kind of come back to life again once I gave them more nutrients. But when we're talking about Snowball Earth, we're talking about glaciations that lasted upwards of 70 million years in total, both the Sturtian and Maranoan. So when we think about 70 million years, it's probably unlikely that life would have survived in a dormant state for that long and then come back to life when conditions came back to normal after a Snowball Earth event if it was that long. Thus, in this scenario in which ice would have completely covered Earth, the only life that likely would have survived would have been chemotrophic life. In other words, life that relies on chemicals to get their energy rather than light. Photo versus chemo. Yes, there is a world in which it's possible that a snowball Earth event could have occurred and chemotrophic life could have been the only ones to survive, and then photosynthesis could have re-evolved after the snowball Earth event because it's a beneficial trait. We see this over and over again in the rock record. It's called convergent evolution, where traits like flying or the shape of a dolphin or shark re-evolve in separate lineages in different times in Earth's history, completely independently of one another, just because that trait or characteristic is beneficial to have. And photosynthesis is a trait or a metabolism that would be really beneficial to evolve. And actually, it has evolved more than once in Earth's history. And I talk about other types of photosynthesizing organisms that have evolved differently than things like plants and trees that we see today in my When Earth Was Purple video, which I'll link up to the top right for you. But we can tell this is not the case for the Snowball Earth event, in that photosynthesis didn't completely go extinct and then re-evolve, because the same photosynthesizers that were around pre-Snowball Earth, the cyanobacteria, were around and still are around after. So it's very unlikely that those guys would have gone extinct and then re-evolved to be the exact same way in every way. So this just didn't happen. We see the same life before and after, thus life did find a way to survive, which is why we now think that it was more of a slush ball Earth, in which there was more slushy, broken up ice, especially near the equator, than a full, thick ice cover around Earth's entire globe. This would have allowed life to persist in deep hydrothermal vent systems, essentially kind of underwater volcano type systems where microbial chemotrophs, microbes that got energy from chemicals rather than light, would have survived, but also in areas near the equator where ice was thin enough and or broken up enough to allow light through for photosynthesis. But there are other factors that could have contributed to the mass extinction other than just rapid cooling and near global ice cover. For example, rapid global increase in salinity would have occurred due to the rapid and near global formation of ice at the time. Obviously, as we know, the salt in the water stays in the water, and the water that freezes is fresh. It turns into fresh ice. It doesn't maintain the salt in its structure when it crystallizes into ice, which is why the water left over after all the ice formed at the surface would have been super, super salty. And yeah, this might have increased the devastation in terms of life and extinction, because life doesn't like a rapid change in ocean chemistry at all, whether it be pH, salinity, temperature, whatever. And so this might have caused more biological devastation, but it's also potentially what prevented Earth from going into an even more drastic snowball Earth condition, or runaway snowball Earth condition, because the increase in salinity of the leftover water prevented it from freezing, because the more saline water is, the more salt that's in there, the lower the freezing point. And this might have prevented further freezing of that really saline water. Another thing that might have worsened the extinctions at the time is a disconnect between the oceans and the atmosphere. Essentially, a lot of ocean circulation, especially surface currents on the ocean, are driven by wind, and wind can't interact with water when there's a layer of ice between the atmosphere and ocean. So this really slowed down ocean circulation, as well as what we call upwelling and downwelling. Upwelling and downwelling are ocean mixing processes, so not necessarily surface currents and circulation, but rather a vertical mixing of the ocean column, which keeps it from getting stagnant and what we call stratified in terms of chemistry and temperature and stuff. And when it's stagnant and stratified, it's really bad for life, because upwelling and downwelling are the processes that mix the water column to bring nutrients up from the deep waters to the surface waters for the photosynthesizers, and then oxygen down from the photosynthesizers to the deep waters for those organisms to continually decompose the organic matter from those photosynthesizers. Essentially, it's a nutrient circulation cycle caused by upwelling and downwelling, which is largely driven by, you guessed it, wind. And when wind can't interact with the water because of a layer of ice, that drastically decreases the vertical mixing of the ocean as well as ocean circulation, leading to ocean stagnation and anoxia, obviously lack of oxygen in the bottom waters, which was already exacerbated by the lack of photosynthesis due to the sea ice alone, and that just likely caused a lot of extinctions on top of the extinctions caused by the ice cover and salinity changes alone. But here's a twist for you. It might have been multiple extinction events instead of just one. Because when you think about it, after the Snowball Earth event, you had a rapid warming ocean chemistry change. Obviously, as we were coming out of the Snowball Earth event, we had salinity decrease from all the fresh water that was tied up in the ice, melting and going back into the ocean, a pH decrease because the warming was associated with atmospheric carbon increase, which obviously decreases ocean pH, and you probably had local anoxia due to phototrophic blooms and stuff. So essentially just rapid atmospheric warming, ocean chemistry change, sea level rise due to all the ice melting right after the Snowball Earth event. And so that could have also caused another mass extinction event or kind of continued mass extinction event. However, it's mostly thought, as I discussed earlier, that the immediate aftermath of the Snowball Earth event was major biodiversification in the Ediacaran and Cambrian periods, likely caused by an increase in ocean circulation and vertical mixing after the ice melted. Again, these are the things that were blocked due to the blocked atmospheric and ocean interaction. So when that came back, that interaction, that fueled ocean circulation and nutrient cycling. Also, there was a resurgence of photosynthesis-driven ecosystems and a radiation of multicellular life, like certain types of algae and animals, which had evolved either just before or during the Snowball Earth event and then radiated after, because obviously multicellularity was this new and fun thing that all the organisms were like, well, this is really beneficial, let's diversify. And obviously that caused chain reactions of evolutionary advancement in the Ediacaran and Cambrian seas. So to answer the question of did Snowball Earth cause a mass extinction event, yeah, most likely, given how extreme the conditions were and how rapidly they got that extreme and how limited life would have been in terms of the environments that it might have survived in. However, was that extinction event bigger than, say, the End Permian mass extinction event that a lot of people deem the largest extinction event of all time? Well, we don't know. The only reason that the End Permian is often deemed the largest extinction event of all time is because we have a fossil record to show it, whereas Snowball Earth and previous mass extinctions, like the one associated with the Great Oxidation Event, which I'll be talking about in a future video, which I'll link up to the screen here in a second, these events are harder to nail down numerically in terms of how many species might have gone extinct because we don't have the fossil record for it, at least not a complete one. Obviously, the fossil record is never complete. However, microbes preserve a lot less often than shelly, skeletonized organisms that evolved later on and mark the End Permian and other mass extinction events that we see in the rock record. So pre-Cambrian or pre 539 million year ago mass extinction events like this one are very hard to see in the rock record. However, we can speculate that yes, these conditions, these climatic changes and environmental changes, which were very rapid at the time, would have caused major devastation. With that, I hope you'll check out my upcoming GOE or Great Oxidation Event mass extinction video, which I will link up to the screen here somewhere. If it's members only right now, it should be out for everybody very soon or within like a week or two. So hold on for that. And with that, thank you so much for watching and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.